Our next guest will help us turn the corner. This morning we talked with Anthony Scaramucci a little bit about one of the sort of pillars of content that we're going to be discussing today, and that was Wall Street and sort of the intersection of Wall Street and Washington. And now one of the other pillars of content and one of the pillars of our economy, and that is Silicon Valley and the world of technology. You know Walt Mossberg, I'm sure. For 22 years, he was the principal technology columnist for the Wall Street Journal. He hasn't stopped there. He is a co-founder of All Things D, which was a series of conferences and other affiliated businesses under the Journal and Dow Jones's imprimatur. But now he is the executive editor of The Verge and editor-at-large of Recode and co-executive producer of the annual Code Conference. He knows just about more than anybody about what's coming in technology, how it is going to change our lives individually and our society. He is as connected as they come and as engaging as they get. Please welcome Walt Mossberg. Nice to have you. Have a seat. So welcome, Walt. I want to begin by just sort of show of hands. How many of you use a cell phone? How many of you use a cell phone for something other than making telephone calls at all? Anything? How many of you use it to pay for things, shop? How many of you use it to control other devices in your home? Your Sonos system, your alarm system, your lights, the smart house? How many of you use it to do banking or financial transactions? A lot. How vulnerable are these people?
I was just thinking that. Well, these people, I'm sure, are super smart, and therefore they've
super
taken
secure.
All of the precautions that you need to take. I'm going to ask before I answer that, how many of you have ever made a banking transaction at a place like Starbucks or an airport or public Wi-Fi? And be honest.
Using public Wi-Fi?
Public Wi-Fi. Well, you people are not the smartest people in the room. There's two kinds of vulnerability. There's privacy and the security, and they are, you know, they're enmeshed in a lot of ways. If you ask Tim Cook at Apple, he would say it's very much the same thing. But I'm going to divide them a little bit. So there's a way to be careful just to protect your privacy, and it would really take us longer than we have here to go through all the different possibilities of how you do that. But then there's pure security. And just to stick with that Wi-Fi public spaces example, anyone sitting in any Starbucks, and I'm not picking on Starbucks, could be any other coffee shop you like or restaurant or anything, and anybody sitting in the Fort Myers airport or any other airport or in this hotel.
How about actually, in this hotel?
In this room.
In the lobby, in this room.
Anybody with a inconspicuous piece of equipment can spoof and pretend that they're the network you're logging into. And you'll get a connection to the internet. You won't know. But everything you do and say is sent to their server of, you know, criminal choice, which is usually in Russia or somewhere like that. And you won't know it. You just won't know it. And they even, as some of you know, imitate your bank's website and so forth. So there's a kind of app you can get that many big companies insist you use when you're doing company business, but I think your business is just as important as company business, and that is called a VPN, Virtual Private
VPN.
Network.
VPN, okay.
And that app basically hides your IP address and is kind of a tunnel through the internet to wherever you're going. And I would just recommend everyone put that on their phone and their laptop.
If I do that, without getting too deep into the weeds here, if I do that, am I secure? Can I go and use that public Wi-Fi?
You're very likely to defeat the kind of attack I just discussed. But these people are coming up with new methods all the time, and there's other security things you should be doing too. What I'm about to say is my opinion, and it will probably depends on your stock holdings or who you work for, you might get annoyed. You're safer with an iPhone than with an Android phone.
Why?
You're not perfectly safe even with an iPhone, because Apple's business model is selling the hardware. And they make, as we all know, a very big margin on that hardware and all of that. And they, starting well before Tim Cook, starting with Steve Jobs, actually on the stage of a conference I run, he started, it was the first time I know of, where he gave a big public lecture about this privacy security stuff. They encrypt that phone, and they're improving the encryption all the time. And you will remember they had a fight with the FBI about that very subject. And Google, by the way, supported them, so I know the people that run Google, they're good people. But Google's got a different business model. They don't make their money off hardware. They make a tiny bit off a tiny amount of hardware. They're an advertising company and a data collection company. And I'm not saying they're doing anything illegal or improper, but because they are just in a different business, really, there's much more, many, many independent studies have shown there's vastly more malware on Android than on Apple.
Will you excuse me while I go turn in my Android phone, please? I've heard in groups like
this. Can I just say,
yeah.
Isn't this just as entertaining as Presley was on the guitar? And the acrobats?
It's Thank just you. As cute.
Thank you for the scheduling.
So in groups like this, I've heard, how many people in this room either have or believe they may have been hacked at one time or another?
Well, that's pretty high.
Maybe 20%. Is it fair to say that there are two types of people in this room, the people who have been hacked and the people who will be?
Oh, yeah. But there's different kinds of hacking. You
right.
Don't, so, for instance,
what are the odds that I'm going to wake up some morning and I'm going to go on my TD Bank account and it's going to say zero?
I don't know.
And that had nothing to do with my profligate spending, by
yes,
the way.
Yes, I was about to say. You have to understand, Taylor, yeah. Taylor, how long have we known each other?
About probably 30 years. I don't know.
A long time. Yeah. I don't know how to put odds on that, but they're not zero.
Yeah.
The question isn't whether you will be hacked. I think you'll all, some institution where you have an account, even if you're not using it anymore, is likely to be hacked. They may not announce it, so you may never know. B, they may announce it, but you don't use that, haven't used that account. This happened to me with Yahoo. I had a Yahoo Mail account. You all know Yahoo's had like two or three giant hacks in a fairly short period of time, to the point where Verizon actually cut the price of the deal to buy them.
Yes, just last
by
week.
By what, 350
300,
million?
400 million, yeah.
So, I had a Yahoo Mail account, and I just stopped using it, not because I thought it was insecure or bad. I don't know. I just switched to something else. And nevertheless, I got notified that, I read that there had been a hack at Yahoo, so I re-logged into my Yahoo account after spending a lot of time trying to remember what the login was. And there was a notice there saying, you may have been compromised, blah, blah, blah. So that, the idea that you may be hacked, even if you don't know you have, covers that case. It covers cases where the company doesn't want to announce that they've been hacked. It covers cases where the company doesn't know they've been hacked. You're probably your personal phone, unless you have malware that is living on your phone, which, as I say, is somewhat more likely on Android than on iPhone, but possible on both of them. It's probably due to some provider or some bank or some service that you use.
Technology and mobility has certainly made our lives more convenient, but there's a cost to it. And now we hear that over the next decade or so, there may be 500 billion discrete devices that are interconnected some way or another. And that may be my doorbell. It may be my garage door opener. It may be Scott Adzik's ability to get medical files on a case he's following here in Southwest Florida, but he's following it here from Children's Hospital in Pennsylvania.
Right.
So what are the dangers as we get so connected and so dependent on our technology? What happens when the cloud bursts, or when, because of a natural disaster or a man-made disaster like on 9/11, these systems don't work?
Geez, Tyler, should I be digging a fallout shelter? These are very dark questions.
Yeah.
So there's a thing in the tech world called the Internet of Things, those 500 billion things which are not people. And that's the Wi-Fi connected doorbell, the Sonos systems, the other things in your home, the light bulbs which from your phone you can, or from your Amazon Echo device, you can change the brightness of them, change the color of them. Those things all are, they all have IP connections on the internet. Those things have almost no security built into them. And this is not to knock the people that make them, because, you know, you wouldn't necessarily think, oh, I'm going to make a light bulb, it's kind of really cool, it has Wi-Fi so that, you know, all your phone and your Echo can control it. They're not thinking, you know, this has any personal data on it, and it doesn't. But we have already had a few cases where people have figured out a way to get in through your thermostat, to get in through one of those things, and to worm their way into your home network, where there are other devices that do have a lot of data, your computer, your phone, your iPad, you know, all those boxes you have connected to your TV that stream, the CNBC app, mm-hmm. whatever. There's a big security problem there.
Is there.
I'm not trying to tell you not to buy them, but just be careful, watch out. Try to you know, follow whatever advice you can get from your tech advisor or from the company that
is there anything router. That you personally won't do on your handheld computer, your cell phone, or your iPad, or your desktop? Are there things that you feel just you're not going to do that? Banking or
I do very little banking on the phone unless I'm on my home network, which has been configured, you know, with all the security features of the routers. In fact, I have an app that can tell me what the status of my routers are and how many things are connected to it. And I'm not a geek. I mean, I have no computer science background. I just sort of tumbled into this. But I know enough about it. So I don't. Even with the VPN, which I talked about, which I think would probably protect me, I'm still not going to, when I go to the airport a little
later. You're not
going
to hook up to.
I'm not going to my banking app.
Yeah.
I'm just not. It's just too much. I mean, it's, you know, unless there was some utterly urgent reason to do banking while I'm at that airport, which I can't sort of imagine, I'm just not going to do that. You save that for home.
Is there a risk back to sort of the second part of my
question? And one other thing, Teller.
Oh, yeah.
I will not any longer log in to a service or a site I frequently use. And I mean Facebook, Twitter, Amazon, where I buy stuff, all of my various work things, and my Apple ID, iTunes Store, that kind of stuff. I won't log into any of those things anymore without something called two-factor authentication.
Explain.
So two-factor authentication means you have a username, you have a password. But even if somebody figures out your password, they still can't get into your account, because every time you log in, and this is a pain in the ass, but every time you log in, they're going to do one of two things. They're either going to text you on your phone a code, a series of numbers that will last for 1 minute that you have to type in. If you don't type it in 1 minute, you have to request a new code, and then you get in. Or, and some of them won't even do that because they think the texting is too insecure, they'll make you use an app. Google makes one called Authenticator, and there are some others, that generates a random number every 1 minute. So you have to go on your phone to this other app, look it up, put the number in, and then you can get in.
Do you have either Google Home or the Amazon Echo in your home?
Yes.
And do you worry that Alexa is listening to everything you say?
I don't, because it's going to sound weird, but...
You're boring. You don't say anything.
I trust Jeff Bezos.
Yeah.
I know he's collecting certain kinds of information, but I trust that when I haven't said the control, I just think that company has a certain amount of integrity. It could be hacked. I've not yet read of a case of it being hacked, so I assume it hasn't been hacked yet. But I don't think the company is deliberately spying on me. But my wife does not trust them.
I am with you. I am a trusting kind of guy.
Well,
but
I happen to know the guy, so.
Yeah, but my colleagues on air absolutely believe that Alexa is listening to everything, and they don't use it as a result. So.
Yeah, my wife.
They're in your wife's camp.
Hits the button, and the ring around the top turns red, and I say to her, if you really think these guys are like you're spying on us all the time, that red thing could just be a decoration.
Yeah.
Mean nothing.
Let's spin forward a little bit, and I'd love to hear what you think. I mean, the cell phone is really a computer in your pocket. Okay, the hardware has advanced, but some of the rapid advances in functionality seem to have plateaued a little bit.
Correct.
What I can do today. It's different, but it's not all that. It's not 2007, right?
No, I was there.
Yeah, it's not 2007. But as you look out 7 years, 10 years hence, what will the connected world, digitization, what will we be doing then that we can't do now?
Well.
Is it driving an autonomous car? Is it?
Yeah, it's driving it's. I don't know that we'll, in 7 years, we'll actually, I'm a little bit of a skeptic about the timeline of purely self-driving cars in significant numbers and significant numbers of places. I think it's going to take longer for both technical reasons and regulatory reasons. It's just going to take longer. But yeah, that's coming. That's real. But the much more fundamental thing that underlies all of this is there's a big thing, and then there's a thing that's not quite as big, but I still think it's important. The big thing is artificial intelligence. So, how many of you have used Siri? How many of you have used the Google Assistant, which is relatively new, just a few months old? How many of you have used Alexa on an Echo, or Cortana on Windows? So these are all... There's a certain artificial intelligence there. I mean, it's not just that it recognizes your voice. It has to understand idioms. It has to understand patterns of conversation. It has to be able to speak back to you. It has to know the subject you're talking about and find the answer. We're really just in the... I asked Bezos less than a year ago on a stage like this. We're just in the first inning, right? He goes, oh, no, we're not in the first inning. We're in the first batter in the first inning. And so this is at least a 10-year project to make a comfortable, natural, reliable, Siri, these things are not reliable. A lot of time, how many people have had, just gotten frustrated by bad answers from these things?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
So there's lots of work to be done by all these companies. And at the same time, they have to balance privacy and they have to balance security.
What will artificial intelligence enable us to do?
Well, it'll enable you to walk into your house and have a whole bunch of things happen. You can see videos about this now, but it's very hard to actually make it happen unless you do a lot of DIY stuff, and it's not secure, as I just finished saying. It'll enable the car. I mean, the reason the cars can drive autonomously is artificial intelligence. Car has to understand, even though it has all this mapping in it, that's much more detailed than the Google Maps on your phone, has to understand what to do in a situation that wasn't foreseen. So it has to have a set of algorithms that give it a little bit of thinking for that situation. Artificial intelligence is just going to drive everything, and not just your phone or whatever device you're carrying, but everything. this running a conference like this will be different in 10 years.
Should we fear artificial intelligence? Should we? Is it the machines are going to take over? What should we fear about it? Let me ask you that way. What should we fear about artificial intelligence?
Well, if they get super really smart, I don't know if this will happen in 10 years, but if they get super duper smart and develop a sort of pseudo sentience, then I would worry about it. I know this sounds ridiculous coming from me at this conference, even you asking the question, but it isn't ridiculous because we're on this path. It's the first batter, so we're a long way from that problem, but we're clearly on the path, and the companies that are on the path have a lot of money and a lot of economic interest in doing this, and consumers want some of these things that will happen. There definitely will be robots in your life, and more to the point, nobody's building a factory that isn't heavily, that isn't heavily full of robots, or a warehouse, by the way. So when you hear so-and-so company is going to build a factory, or so-and-so is going to build a big fulfillment center, the jobs that go along with that factory, even if they are additive and there are some new jobs, are like going to be a tenth of what they would have been for the same kind of facility. When I started as a reporter, I started in Detroit covering the car industry. General Motors had 1 million employees. 1 million. I don't know what they have now, but it's
300,000, 400,000 maybe.
Something like that.
Which company in artificial intelligence leads the way? Is it Google? Is it
Amazon? I think Google has the edge right now. It's not like you can tell a big difference right now. They're weak. Like, for instance, Apple had a lead, and I think they actually blew it. I don't think they put enough emphasis on it. I think they now have their foot on the pedal, but, you know. So Apple's thing is better at some things. It's worse than Google's at others. Google's is better at some things than Amazon. Amazon is better than Apple and Google at some other things. They all, you know, I don't think there's an absolute clear leader, many laps ahead of the other guy. Maybe IBM Watson, but that's not right in your consumer device.
What is Amazon? Is it a merchant? Is it a cloud company? Is it an AI company? What is it?
It's a eat the world merchant that, you know, has been just brilliant at doing it, including, in my opinion, maybe somebody here has had a bunch of bad experiences with them, but, you know, I think they've cared a lot about keeping customers happy. It's also a giant cloud company. A lot of other things, services that you use, run off Amazon's commercialization of its servers. Mm-hmm. And that's a big part of their business. And now it's deeply into AI. I mean, Bezos told me he thinks it's really a pillar of his company going forward. And he told me 1,000 people worked on the development of the Echo device, which, by the way, is separate from the Alexa service, which is their AI software and cloud service, which they can license to other devices.
Just to broaden out, I want to pick up pace and get a lot in. The connected world, digitization and technology, is it going to help poor people, poor countries, or are the benefits of it going to accrue more to the wealthy? In other words, is it going to help the rich or the poor more?
Well, I think it has a tremendous potential to help the poor, both in the poor who live in rich countries and the countries themselves that are poor. And some of the Silicon Valley giants are doing work in these poor countries. But, you know, it's like everything else. I mean, the fruits of this stuff, as far as I know, when the automobile industry came out, the fruits of it first went to the countries with higher incomes that could afford it. Eventually, it made its way to a poorer country somewhere and had a tremendous, generally positive impact there. Railroads, you know, other things. I think we are now moving into a phase where this has become a big deal. I mean, Android phones, you know, there are $75, $50 Android phones made by companies you've never heard of, based in China, based in India, that are using an open version of Android that does not even require them to have any Google services on them. Like, if you have an Android phone, you'll see, you know, Google Search, Gmail, Google Maps, all those things. But there's an open version of Android that Google doesn't even have to know you're using. And in the poorer, the developing world, those phones are made at a profit for very little money, and they don't have any Google stuff on them. And so, yeah, I mean, there's a vast number
there's
of
these
phones.
There's a potential to
the
help
world.
Poor people and poor countries.
Well, there's a lot of, if you had, instead of me, if you were lucky enough to have Bill and Melinda Gates up here, they would tell you stories about farmers in Kenya using very cheap smartphones to, or even flip phones to find out the market price for their crop and the weather, things that they never had access to that really have a direct economic bearing.
I can think of six companies, that U.S. companies, that I think are sort of the pillars, the six horsemen of the tech economy. One would be Google, one would be Facebook, Apple, Amazon, Microsoft, and Netflix. Is there another one that you would say, Tyler, that's the one you really ought to keep your eye on?
Actually, I wouldn't put Netflix in that list.
You wouldn't.
And I love Netflix, but the other five are all what you call platform companies.
Platform companies. Some more hardware, some more software.
Yeah, but they all have a platform that is a software platform, and in the case of, well, really all of them have begun to have a hardware platform as well. Apple may be better known for hardware, but of course it has a big software platform. There are a billion. Apple's mobile operating system, think of these figures for a minute if you want to understand the scale. So iPhones, iOS, which as you know is the operating system on iPhones, has about 14% of the global market, 1/4. The rest of it is Android. But Apple takes 80 or 90% of the profits out of the entire world smartphone market. And Apple has sold a billion iOS devices. So there's 7 billion people on Earth. You can just do the math. If they have 14% and they've sold a billion devices, now they're not all active maybe anymore or whatever. No, I think they say it's a billion active devices. So there's like billions of Android devices. And not very many Windows Mobile or BlackBerry devices left anymore, but if you add them up, these are not only in the rich countries. They're in poor countries. They may be in the middle class in those countries. I don't know if they're getting to the very poorest people, but they're everywhere.
What is, very quickly, what is the most technologically advanced country in the world in terms of however you want to measure it? Which country is ahead?
Different countries have strengths. Mm-hmm. Some of them are surprising. You know, India has what, a billion?
200 million, a
billion,
billion
four, two, something yeah. like that, billion. They have a middle class in India that is the size of the population in the entire United States. Mm-hmm. So they have tech in India. And there are American and other tech companies that have facilities there. China is beginning to create its own tech industry that doesn't just make our stuff to our specifications, but actually designs its own and makes its own. There are some beautiful cell phones made in China and laptops and probably industrial technology as well. But I think we still are holding on to being the leaders in tech. In the intellectual property of tech, software, hardware, whatever. For a long while, we had terrible cell speed and coverage compared to other countries. We still fall by the wayside somewhat on coverage just because we're very large and we have very large states like Wyoming with very low population densities where the economics of covering it are difficult. But our speeds are, I think, quite good now, and our home broadband speeds have gotten up there. There are countries like South Korea which are very compact. They have about 50 million people. I think that's roughly the right number. And they're in a very compact area, and that means they can have faster speeds. But, and of course, Samsung and LG are very important tech companies, but I think we still are holding on to that lead.
Let's turn to Silicon Valley and the new administration. What does Silicon Valley think or fear about the Trump administration? He has said, he's not an email user, he's only a Twitter user, he's not an email user. He once said that he thought the most secure way to communicate was by courier.
Yeah, I read that, yeah.
He has pointed the finger at Apple for manufacturing overseas. He said boycott Apple when they refused to decrypt their phone after the Santa Barbara massacre. He has pointed the finger at Amazon and Jeff Bezos personally, perhaps because he doesn't like the way the Washington Post covers him, but he has said Amazon may have an antitrust problem. As you live in D.C., what does Silicon Valley think the impact of a Trump administration will be on it? And obviously, immigration is a big part of it. You look at the workforces of the engineering of a lot of the Silicon Valley companies, the leadership of a lot of the Silicon Valley companies.
Yeah, I wrote a column about this. Quite a few of the major companies, Google, Microsoft, I'm blanking, but others, their CEOs are immigrants. Andy Grove, the great ex-Intel CEO. Grove was a Hungarian who fled the communist crackdown in the 50s. Steve Jobs, probably the greatest tech icon of our time, was the biological son of a Syrian, that's ironic, but it's true, a Syrian, I don't think he was a refugee, but he was an immigrant, and there is a difference between those terms. So, and then as you go down the workforce, as you mentioned, Tyler, you see in the engineering corps and the product management corps, I don't think it's a majority of the workers, but it's a significant minority. I read a figure that said 40%. I don't know if it's true, but it doesn't seem wrong to me just based on my 25 years of going there and having meetings with folks who come from India and Pakistan and Russia and Israel and England and France and just all of these, and China and Japan and all these different countries. The American companies also have not just factories, but R&D labs in places like Israel. Israel is a very small country in land area, as you know, because the map gets printed almost every day in somewhere. But partly because of their military research, once these folks get out of the military, they start tech companies. It has a very high density of tech companies, which tend to get bought by American big tech companies. And then the American tech companies will build a lab there. So untangling our tech industry from immigration or from foreign investment is, I think it would deal a severe blow to them. So they're all afraid, they're all worried, they're all trying to figure it out. I don't think they know. I mean, what is it, been a month? They don't know, but they're concerned about it. They're quite concerned about it.
Well, we got to leave it there. I could talk all afternoon, and I'm sure the audience would love to hear you talk all afternoon.
I'm
pretty sure about it.
I don't play the guitar. But.
Thank you so much. Walt Mossberg, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much. That was wonderful. Really appreciate it.